Welcome back, everyone, to Man Manga Boys. Beautiful manga reading log this week. I'm just going to start off with Frieren Volume 3. I already read that last week, but I didn't talk about it because I left it at home. And I forgot that I left it at home. And so that's why I kind of want to just quickly talk about it. It was actually my favorite volume of Frieren so far, Frieren. I really did enjoy the way that it ended with our nice, fun little town that's corrupted by demons. I think maybe I just really like to see demons fight each other. I think that's a big thing for me, apparently. So yeah, I actually did like this one quite a bit. I thought that was a very interesting ending, and I thought it was cool how the demon kind of aura had a link to Frieren's past, or Frieren's past, so I thought that was very cool. And then, of course, you know, it kind of leads up to the path to meeting that priest and getting poisoned, which I thought was pretty funny, and the big hamburger steak and all that was pretty good. Anyways, that's enough of that. Let's get into what I actually read this week. Well, I was at the beach, and so you know what that means. I read Grand Blue Dreaming, Volume 14 and 15. I'm now caught up with everything that I have. I don't know if there is more out, and I'm just missing it, waiting for it. But we finish up with the beautiful arc with, you know, the mom slash the aunt here for Chiyo. And so that was interesting to see how she was like so mean and to her daughter. But however, we find out that the mom is actually deaf. There we go. So yes, we find that out, and then we're like, oh, I see. It's okay. Oh, not Chiyo. Chisa. I knew it was something else. But we also have Aina. Aina has a crush on Yori, and of course, Kohei is trying to get him to get her to admit that to him, but it doesn't happen, does it? No sirree. We also get Volume 15 here. We're back at home base. We're back at Blue Dreaming. We're at the boys. We went overseas. We see the twins. We see all that stuff happening. It's a beautiful time. We get to go and have another nice party here. We also do another meet and greet, and we go diving. And so that was very cool. You know, we don't always get to go diving. It's pretty funny. Also, we see a side story with the teacher. The teacher ends up being caught up in their antics as well, which I think is hilarious. So that was also great. But overall, this has just been a pretty funny ride so far. More of what to expect. The storyline is progressing further through that. I'm curious to see, though, who Yori ends up with. We have GTO 4567. So this is pretty good pace, in my opinion, to read at four volumes a week. I doubt I'll keep it up, but I might. We find out the PE coach is a total perv, and so we get him totally taken care of GTO style. We also get Doraemon. I was dying laughing at this Doraemon shtick. I have read this before, so I knew it was coming and everything like that. You know, and Onizuka is just a huge tank. He's a beast, able to take out that guy with steroids. I don't know what he was doing, but whatever, with the racing and things like that. I was like, dude, what? How are you actually winning? Are you doing anything, or is he just getting heated for no reason? The Devil Man was super funny. His cosplay there, died over that. And then we start the next journey, the next arc, with this student who everybody says is slow and is dumb, and so she's bullied very frequently, and then she actually ends up winning this. She doesn't win, she gets second place in this idol contest thing, and everyone's like trying to sign her and everything like that. She's super popular, and the winner is like totally shafted. Like, man, who cares about winning? She's gonna just do porn later anyways. No one cares. We also get the principal. He's here seeing Onizaka, and he catches him, eyeballing girls and feeling them up on the train. And so Onizaka is watching him, and the principal's freaking out. He's dreaming about stabbing him and killing him. He's pissing blood, and he's trying to pass a kidney stone. And once he passes it, what happens? But Onizaka comes right back for him. We do reach a snag, though. Onizaka is on the path to be getting fired, and this guy right here is all after the girl who's very interested in him. Ikichi, poor Ikichi. So his plan is to actually bring the girl over to her over to his house, and meanwhile he's going to make Onizaka take a test, and he's going to take the test too. And if Onizaka doesn't get placed number one, he's gonna resign. He's also the teacher who's interested in that woman, or that female teacher, is also like tormented by the school superintendent's daughter. I believe that's who it was. Very interesting. The students try to help out for Onizaka because most of them are his friends now, at least in the boy side. And they're trying to make it through for him, but you can see the teacher here is a total creeper. He's got this pillow made of her. He sleeps in pajamas made of her. He drinks out of a glass made out of her. Meanwhile, Onizaka is spending a whole week with her studying, trying to do better at the test. And, you know, he'll get there, I swear. But we also end on one of the funniest panels known to mankind, and it is maybe in the last volume on accident. Oops. It is, in fact, a beautiful elephant sneezes right all over the superintendent. I died laughing here. That's too good. At the end of this one, though, he's shot and he's bolts. He's bleeding out. Oh my God, what's going to happen? Well, he still passed the test anyways because he's a tank. He's a beast. Onizaka is a winner. So you can't go wrong there. However, he killed a girl at the end. So anyways, I am really enjoying this series quite a lot. We're into an interesting arc where a student who is not just tormenting Onizaka, but she's tormenting everybody. And so that's a pretty big shift in the paradigm, since usually it's everybody against Onizaka, but in this case, it's actually not everyone against Onizaka. So that's quite interesting, I have to say. Liking that direction. That's about as far as I got when I read GTO when it was coming out volume by volume. I used to buy them at the Barnes & Noble and Borders bookstores, actually. Even on Walden's, I think I bought maybe one or two volumes from Walden's, if you guys even can imagine what that would look like. But yes, that's where I used to buy them. And I don't think I bought anything else from them. I think the rest I bought online in 2020, actually. So yeah. Anyways, Prison School, volume 11. Prison School keeps prison schooling. We have a beautiful tower here. We somehow have to get the main crew all the way over to Andre the giant. He is literally a giant now. He has grown in size. It's hilarious to me. But do we really have full control over Andre? Seems sus, honestly. But I have been loving it. They have to start up Project Babel to take down the official student council. So it's Shadow Council versus official student council. Very interesting. We also have the boys trying to help out here. Not the boys from Amazon, but the boys from the original Prison School season. They have their beloved PBR on top of our head here, so that's great. But Kate is quite wily and difficult to take down. We also have a nice plan to bring back the president. This was a very interesting plan. I thought that was pretty funny. And the father, the principal, the headmaster, is in a strange, weird thing going on where he's found this girl and he has amnesia. And she tells him that they're married and they have sex like a few times. And like apparently the girl is like fighting with her fiance about naming this cat. And I like, wowie zowie, I was loving it. It was pretty funny stuff. So yes, I am definitely enjoying. Ooh, and then we also have some straight up penis, straight up erection, several chapters long of it, actually. And that was an interesting choice, I gotta say, but definitely it seems effective against the girls, so that was cool. But yeah, I have been enjoying this still quite a lot. People say the ending is not great. I mean, I could see it not being that great. The last volume was not as good as this one, but it still was pretty good. So hopefully, you know, we don't just like tank like we did kind of at Raw Hero, just like ended, which was kind of upsetting, but apparently it might do that. Yakuza Volume 2, Reincarnation. So Yakuza has gotten a lot better since I last wrote it, I have to say. And last time I was pretty happy with it. We find out that our main character here has two skill trees, one on each arm, and can take down demons. They also start to delve into the kind of mystical elements of things. And we're working to try to take down the demons and enter this kind of a dungeon thing, it seems like, which was pretty cool. I'm very interested to see what direction the series goes in, because it doesn't seem like humans can do too much about demons, but it does seem like demons know what the reincarnation thing is. And so I'm very excited to see how this kind of goes and progresses. Speaking of awesome things that you know, have been pretty good so far, and I thought I was just kind of being biased towards, Reign of the Seven Spellblades. So it's revealed to us that our, you know, pink-haired girl actually has the seven spellblades, and that there is actually seven, not six. I remember I saw that and I was like, that seems weird because she definitely has a spellblade and it definitely says seven. Well, I didn't think that she had a spellblade. I thought she was going to get one since she was featured so heavily on the covers, but whatever. She ends up having one. And so that was really cool. So Nanao has a seventh spellblade, secret hidden one, and Mr. Andrews here has to help them take down the Garuda. Very sweet fight. I really enjoyed it. Cool use of magic and sword spells. We also have this cool little diagram here for the trolls from the previous events in Volume 1, I think. Maybe it was Volume 2. And we find out that this girl actually has mystical beast eye called a basilisk in her eye and her hand. Like, what? People can do this? And apparently that's like not uncommon to do, but the hand, I guess, is pretty tricky. So I was like, holy shit. And she was experimenting on people and she gave the troll the power to speak human language. And I was like, damn. So I really enjoyed this. It was really fucked up, really enjoyable. I can't wait to read more of this. And our main character even goes after her boss and is like, you did this with her, didn't you? And he's like, and so that's how it ended. And I was like, shit, I can't leave it in there. We also lastly have the weakest contestant in all of space and time, Volume 1. This is an interesting concept. I thought it was, you know, this guy ends up being the weakest thing in the world and like, you know, that sucks for him. But no, it's actually a tournament to determine who's the weakest of all time. So I thought he was reincarnated into a world where he's the weakest. No, these five right here are the weakest in all space and time. And they were in a tournament where the winner was actually the, you know, the person who died the most and was the biggest loser. And so all five of these people have to work together to survive, otherwise, you know, they'll die because they escape the arena. Once you escape the arena, then you can die. And the gods are trying to get some enjoyment out of this, so they're trying for these people to die. So the idea is the gods are trying to convince these creatures that are on this planet to take out these people who are in that tournament. They're all from different space times, and so that's why it says space and time. So like he's from the human space time, he's from the cartoon space time, that kind of thing. So they're like different universes or multiverses. And if you're a fan of Marvel, that would be kind of how to explain it. This guy thinks he's a war robot. He's actually a vacuum robot, which was hilarious. She's a slime who takes the image out of a girl that he was thinking about. So that's interesting. This weapon here, that's a tank. This one is like the weakest tank in the tank space and time because it can't turn. So there's like wicked funny stuff here that is like also scary because like, you know, this guy's gonna die, he's gonna die for real, and so are these other people. Meanwhile, the gods are just watching and laughing and clapping, and so it's an interesting tale. I definitely am enjoying this more than I thought I was going to because it's a new and fresh kind of take on it. It's a death game, which I didn't really think it was gonna be, but it, you know, I saw the back cover before I bought it, and so I knew it was a death game. But I didn't realize it was going to be a tournament for the weakest people. I just read the title, saw it was a death game, thought, that's interesting to see a character reincarnated as the weakest creature of all space and time and in a death game. But no, it's not that way. So I was very happy to be surprised with that. So I'm loving this title, actually. If you like death games, you know, I'm only one volume in, but I would recommend checking it out. Or at least waiting for, you know, a few more volumes to come out and then considering checking it out. I wouldn't write it off quite yet. But that is what I read this week. What did you read this week? Did you read anything good? Did you even read at all? Did you? Really? Really, did you? That backlog's looking at you. You should probably read it. You know, just saying. Anyways, thank you so much for watching. Please like, comment, subscribe if you enjoyed this video. And we'll see you next time. Bye-bye.